of church.
Amen.
He said, surprise, so I'm ready. So it ain't going to surprise you, but I'm going to surprise you. Chaplain Ian Perry, you don't mind coming to set up your word for the congregation, amen?
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Praise God.
Praise God.
Let you know, I wore this suit for him. I don't wear a suit. Because, you know, when you get to work, you got to take it off. And I work with a lot of people that are in prisons, do a lot of prison ministry. That's where I met him. Just to give you a little history real quick, I was born in Saigon, South Vietnam, and grew up in West Africa. God taught me a lot. He taught me that there's no one color, there's no one age, and there's no one people but God's people.
Yes.
I can remember that the thing, I was changed in my life because you got to imagine this. Here, I'm white. And I ran away in Africa because I thought life was hard. And I was in a country called Togo, and I went to Ghana. I forgot that I was white. And I was in an African village, and I thought I could blend in. You see, God was teaching me that there's no color. It's what's inside here. You see, when we die, there's not going to be Spanish. There's not going to be English. There's going to be God's letters. And we need to start working now. The message I want to give you, real short and sweet, we got to start working together. You look at the book of Nehemiah. They built a wall. They built it together. You see, when the time is to go back to heaven, we're not going to go back as a Methodist church, Episcopal church, a Church Baptist church. We're going to go together as one church. Now, the Bible mentions the church of God. It mentions the church of God, for God, by one God. Now, I'm a pastor. I actually got ordained in the church of God, but that's not the church of God that God's talking about. He's talking about his church. You see, when we go to heaven, let me give you an example. There was a race with some handicapped kids. That's what I do to make money, because in my church, I don't accept any money. We don't have anything said, but I still won't accept any money because, you see, it has to go to the people that it needs. Because my people are everybody's people. But you see, the handicapped kids were running in a race. And this is a true story. One kid fell. And this kid that's running, he's just running good. He stopped. And he went over to the child and he picked him up. And the coach is hollering, go, go, go. You know what he did? He picked up the child,
yes,
and he walked across the finish line together.
Amen.
That's what the churches need to start doing. We need to start doing. We're going to go to heaven together. What do I mean by that? The next time you're driving by a church that's closing its doors, don't ask what the denomination is. Pull in there and pray for them, because they're going to reach people that you won't reach. You need to start praying for the people in that church. You need to pick up the newspaper and start praying over not what's in it, but the people who read it. You need to pray over that computer, because there's things in that computer you shouldn't be looking at. You need to pray for the people that look at the computer and the people that are in the computer. You see, God is only about Him. You see, when you go to heaven, you're not going to be able to say, my pastor did this, my mama said this, my father said this. You will have to answer for you. God is waiting to shout from the top of the treetops and the buildings, your secret sin. Now there's the thing. What are you going to do when God opens up it and all of a sudden everyone sees what you've been thinking? You think you're slick because you turn the lights down low, but God's got a high beam right on you. You see, my concern is the prophecy, not prophecy, the gospel that you see on TV. It's called the gospel of being prophet and learning about money and how good it is. You look in the Bible, the people that were the most successful didn't have money, they had God. If we start worrying about God, God will worry about us.
Yes.
Now, just like you said today, you know, you say you have to go to God through Jesus. Well, I tell my people, because I go out a lot, I was just in Haiti a few months ago, the second time I've been there, and I was trying to explain Jesus. I speak French, learned it in Africa. And what I say is, and I want you all to think of this, so when you speak to somebody about Jesus, because most of the people I speak to don't know who God is, or they have heard of God. You've heard of President Obama, but do you know him? You know of him. So many people know of Jesus, but they don't know Jesus. You see, I explain it like this. When you go to an office and there's an executive secretary there, you can't go speak to the boss until you go to the executive secretary.
That's right.
What you say to that executive secretary, you're speaking to the boss. You treat her bad, you ain't getting in. Without her permission, you're not getting in. Jesus is sitting in the front office, in front of God, and you're not going to get into heaven, you're not going to talk to God unless he opens that door. He's the one that says what the rules are, whether you like them or not. And I tell my church this, when God says no, he means no. And when he says yes, yes means yes. We don't have to agree with everything in the Word. It's the Word. How many things in life we don't agree with, but we got to do it. How many things? God said some things. I'll be honest, in my view, I wish, and it's a wish, that Israel would get along with Palestine. But God says, pray for Israel. It doesn't matter what I think, it matters what God thinks. Back to the issue real quick, and I'll close. When was the last time you shared the gospel with somebody? I don't mean I'll pray for you. I mean, you're walking there, and every day you say, who did I speak about the gospel to somebody new?
I know that's right.
Did you go to the store and see someone cry and put your arm near them sometimes? You can't touch them and say, I want to pray for you. Now, don't say Jesus loves you. They've heard that, but they'll listen to it. May I pray for you? May I pray for your family? When was the last time you went to a jail and said, is there somebody there I can visit? You see, we ought to have prayer vigils outside of that jail because there's somebody in there that needs to be spoken to. Those are our fathers and our new mothers that are going to be marrying our kids. They are our leaders of tomorrow. We need to be just like the Arabs. We need to take possession. We need to go. You know what the Jews do? The Jews, when someone gets arrested, they send 12 men to the same judge. And they say to him, he's ours. And if he does this again, he's out. When was the last time a church claimed possession of the people in there? They are our sons. They are our daughters that are in there. We need to take possession of them. Stop thinking they're second-class citizens because they are our blood. The Word says they are our brothers. They are our sisters. What I'm trying to say to you today, share the gospel. Don't listen to a sermon. Be a sermon.
Amen.
Don't hear a sermon, live a sermon.
Yes.
You can hear anything you want, but God is watching what you do right now.
Yes,
he is watching everything you do, everything you think, everything you say. We're all professing Christians, but how many of us are doing it so we can look good? Look at these empty pews. We should be dragging the people in. They should be saying right now, I got to go to that church that will leave me alone.
Yes.
But when they come in, they'll bring other people.
Yes.
You see, out in St. Cloud, they got a restaurant called KKK. You ever heard of the Coffee Cup Cafe? But now they support us. We give food to the homeless. They've even changed the name to Coffee Cup. God is stepping in the neighborhood.
Amen.
God is the one who's running the show, not us.
Yes.
I'm tired of people complaining. We need to start reading the Word. Every answer to every problem is in the Word. So I'm asking you today, I want you to share the gospel. Go, if you don't want to share the gospel, you got a relative, a daughter or a son that's in your room, right? In your house. When they leave that room, I want you to go into that room just like this, take out the Bible, and says, listen, I don't know what to say and pray. I'm just going to sit here with the Word, and I'm going to meditate over their life, and I'm going to get them to change, and they're not. what it looks like inside of a jail. They're not going to know what it looks like inside of a hospital. My kids are God's property. They're going to rebuke you. You sit there every day and you fight that battle because, you know, there's one person. There's God up here and there's your daughter there, your son. You need to be an intercessor. You need to hold the hand of God and you need to hold the hand of your child and say, I'm not going to have nothing touch my child. We're praising about getting better cars, but how come we're not praying for our kids?
Right.
We need to start praying for our kids. We need to start lifting them up and show them what kind of fathers we can be.
Yes.
We need to show what kind of mothers we can be. Fathers need to start standing up and taking control and being in the real man. Be a spiritual father. Sit up there and read that Bible. Turn that TV off. You see, I told my son the other day, well, that's about two years ago, wasn't my dad. I said, Eric, I wanted you to know about praying. So I said, let's kneel down and pray before we fish.
Amen.
So we kneel down and he gives one kiss. Lord, Father, God, can you give us the fish we need? Now let me tell you about it, because that's a kid's prayer. I had put a bait on his hook and I set it about 2 inches of water since I didn't want it to swim wet. Now I knew the bass wasn't going to go in the water like this. And I'm not joking, this really happened. After we finished praying, we went and picked up the fishing rod, and there was a 12-inch bass on it. It was enough to feed my son. His prayers got answered. Why is that so important? When you teach your kids, we went out to Halloween a year and a half ago. We do this every year now. We go out to Halloween and give out free Cokes and free sodas. And some of the restaurants don't like that because we have a huge line. I saw my son evangelize. It's powerful. There was a man dressed just like death himself. He was good. I mean, he looked really good. I had to commend him on that. And I see this little 8-year-old boy, not preaching out of a little book, just saying how God loves him and how he changed his life. And then he said, I heard him, who's your father? He pointed him. And then the next thing I know, he left. He left the Halloween thing because a little 8-year-old boy told them the power of Jesus. If we can start doing that with our kids,
amen,
this world's going to change.
Right.
We're going to bring this country back to God. We're belongs. You see, we sent all these missionaries to Africa. We need missionaries here now.
Right.
I can actually introduce you to Africans that come straight here. My wife's from Guatemala. I'm learning to speak Spanish and need to speak it better. But she tells me, all these people are coming to America. We've lost God. God has turned the volume off because we have disrespected him. We come into the sanctuary and we think of things and not his name.
Well,
how many times do we go into church? Don't raise your hands, please. Have you thought about what you're going to eat when you get towards the end? Or where you're going to go? Really, you should be thinking, how can I please Jesus today?
That's right.
How is God, he's preaching everything, but Lord, talk to me. Who can I share the gospel with? The next thing you'll know is somebody sitting next to you that's eating ramen soup every night for dinner. He's got two or three kids with no clothes. No saying. Slip some money to them and pray over them. Go home and pray over them. Don't forget, go back into that bedroom and pray for that child. Pray for that child every day. Pray for that husband that doesn't come home. That husband that wants to drink. Go ahead. Go to the bar that he goes to and pray in that parking lot. Go to the 7-Eleven he buys his drinks and pray in the alcohol section that when he walks in there, he's going to get sick when he touches it because the power of God's going to touch him. Don't tell him he's doing wrong. Let God tell him he's doing wrong. But you use the power of God. And you know what? That 7-Eleven will change. That bar will close. But it takes you, each individual soldier, that are in a war to fight.
Amen.
The military is that way. I was in the Marine Corps. Every man counts. Don't worry about the big mission. Worry about your battle. Your battle. Your battle. You got an assigned job to do. You do it well. The person who cleans this floor has an assigned battle. This pastor has an assigned battle. If we don't do all our jobs, it won't work. We need to support each other. Stop bickering. Pick up the word and just march forward. Praise God.